or two inside. In mid-October 1944, Ted Hall left Los Alamos and took the train home for 2 weeks of leave. He celebrated his 19th birthday with his parents in New York City. The next day, October 21st, Hall went to visit Seville Sachs, his former college roommate. Ted found Sachs at Sachs's mother's small apartment, Manhattan apartment. While his mother ironed in one room, Sachs led Hall to another and closed the door. In hushed voices, Hall told his friend about his decision. But Hall wondered, how does one go about handling military secrets to the Soviet Union? Sachs had no idea. They talked over options and made a plan. Later that day, Hall walked to the offices of a company called Amtrong, a Soviet import-export business. This was the company KGB agent Semyon Simonov had worked for. Many of the Amtrong employees doubled as Soviet spies. Hall didn't know this, it just seemed like a good place to start. Hall entered the building and found himself in a warehouse. He saw a worker stacking boxes and approached him. "I want to speak to someone about an important military issue," Hall said. The worker knew the FBI kept watch on the building. He told Hall to leave immediately. Hall persisted, asking if there was someone else he could talk to. The man quickly gave Hall a name, Sergei Kurnonkov, along with a phone number. Then he turned back to his boxes. Hall recognized Kurnonkov's name. He was a Soviet journalist based in New York. Hall had read his articles. Was he also a secret agent for the KGB? Hall didn't know, but at least it was a lead. He called the number. Kurnonkov invited the young man to drop by his apartment. The next day, Hall and Kurnonkov sat in the Soviet journalist's living room. As soon as Hall began talking, Kurnonkov realized his young guest had an exceptionally keen mind. The young man was also clearly nervous, making aimless small talk and biting his nails. Kurnonkov filled two small glasses with vodka. Hall downed his drink. Kurnonkov poured him another. "TH is 19 years old," Kurnonkov reported to his KGB contact in New York. Kurnonkov was, in fact, a spy. Pale and slightly pimply face, carelessly dressed, you can tell his boots haven't been cleaned in a long time. His socks are bunched up around the ankles. Beginning to relax, Hall turned the conversation to Los Alamos. He was working there, he told Kurnonkov, alongside some of the world's most famous scientists. They were trying to build a secret weapon. Kurnonkov listened, asking himself, can this pimply kid really be a physicist? Does he really have access to top secret information? Reaching for a pile of newspaper clippings, Kurnonkov showed Hall an article about a new type of missile being developed in the United States. He asked if this is what Hall was working on. "No," Hall said, "it's much worse than that." Kurnonkov told him to continue. Hall said he was helping to build an atomic bomb. He was starting to explain its destructive power when Kurnonkov cut him off. "Do you understand what you are doing?" Kurnonkov demanded. "What makes you think you should reveal USA secret for the USSR's sake? The Soviet Union is the only country that can be trusted with such a terrible thing," said Hall. "But since we can't take it away from other countries, the USSR ought to be aware of its existence and stay abreast of the progress of experiments and construction." "Well," said Kurnonkov, "how do we know that you're not just an agent of the U.S. government trying to trap me?" "You don't. Why don't you just write your ideas or whatever you want to tell us and give it to me?" "I've already done that." Hall pulled out a folder and handed it to Kurnonkov. Inside was what Kurnonkov described as a neatly written report outlining the basic scientific principles of the atomic bomb. "Show this to any physicist," Hall said, pointing to the papers. "He'll understand what it's about." Kurnonkov still couldn't figure out if he was being set up by the FBI or handed the gift of a lifetime. He stepped into the next room and asked his wife to go outside and check for signs that the building was being watched. She walked around the block, seeing nothing to make her suspicious. Kurnonkov decided the potential payoff was worth the risk. He took Hall's folder, promising to check into everything and get back to Hall very soon. Hall explained that he'd be leaving in 3 days for Los Alamos, and once there would be nearly impossible to reach. Army sensors read the mail and listened to the phone calls. Maybe they could use his friend Seville Sachs as a courier, Hall suggested. Then he left. Kurnonkov handed Hall's folder to his wife. He put on his coat, stepped into the street, and started to walk. If American agents were watching the building, he figured, they'd follow him. A few minutes later, his wife walked out of the building with Hall's folder in her purse. On his last day in New York, Hall went to lunch with his father and then on to Penn Station to catch its train. He was standing in the busy station chatting with his dad when he noticed someone watching him. It was Sergei Kurnikov. He walked to Kurnikov. They lowered their voices. Their lowered voices were drowned out by the surrounding conversations and echoes of footsteps on marble floors. Hall's offer to provide information had been accepted by the KGB, Kurnikov said. Savile Sachs would act as a courier between Hall and the Soviets. Hall boarded his train and headed west. His neatly written report headed east to Moscow. The KGB's chief of foreign intelligence, Paul Fitton said, Hall's information is of great interest to us. That was a massive understatement. Top Soviet officials like Fitton lived in terror of Joseph Stalin. Anyone who angered or disappointed the Soviet dictator could wind up in Siberian prison camp or with a bullet in the brain. Now, after years of agonizing frustration, Fitton could boast of having a physicist not just inside the Manhattan Project, but inside Los Alamos itself. It was pure luck, but he'd take it. Meanwhile, Harry Gold and his KGB contact, Anatoly Yakov, were still looking for Klaus Fuchs. Our principal trouble, Gold later said, was to decide whether Klaus, for some reason, was unable to keep the meetings if he was still in New York, or whether he had actually left New York. From the KGB offices in Moscow, Yakov learned that Fuchs had a sister named Crystal Heinemann living in Cambridge, Massachusetts. She was a communist, and her brother was in touch with the Soviets, and knew her brother was in touch with the Soviets. If a Soviet agent ever needed to reach Fuchs, secret passwords had been arranged by which the agent could make himself known to Heinemann. In early November, Gold took the bus to Cambridge and found Hyman's house. He rang the front doorbell. The door was opened, Gold recalled, by an exceedingly beautiful woman. "I bring you greetings from Max," said Gold. "Oh," Crystal Heinemann responded, "I heard Max had twins." "Yes, 7 days ago." Now Heinemann knew her visitor had come from the Soviets. She invited Gold inside and was introduced him to her three young children. Gold asked if she knew where her brother was. "Yes," she said. "He had transferred somewhere in southwest United States. He'd be in Cambridge for a visit sometime around Christmas." "So I could see him then," Gold reported Yakov. "I was so overjoyed that I stayed for lunch." The moment he'd heard southwest United States, Gold figured Fuchs must be at Los Alamos. When Oppenheimer realized he needed to design a new type of plutonium bomb, he'd called for extra help. Fuchs and the British team had moved from New York to Los Alamos in August 1944. Once there, Fuchs was unable to contact Gold, knowing the Army listened to phone calls and read the mail. But he knew the Soviets. He knew they would find him. Fuchs got to work and quickly became a valuable member of the Los Alamos team. "He worked days and nights," Hans Beth would later say. "He contributed very greatly to the success of the Los Alamos project." Fuchs was given a tiny tech area office overlooking a pond. He got there before 8 every morning and stayed late into the night. At lunchtime, he stood at the pond feeding ducks alone. "He's all ears and no mouth," a fellow Los Alamos physicist complained. "You talk about your work to him, but you never feel he's giving you back anything." After work, Fuchs walked back to his room in the bachelor dormitory number 102. The wife of the Italian physicist used to watch him march slowly past their window, his pale owlish face turned down toward the muddy path. She named him Paverno, the pitiful one. In the dorm, Fuchs' only visitor was a scientist in the adjoining room, Richard Feynman. They often sat up late together, Fuchs smoking, Feynman sipping orange juice. "Klaus," Feynman teased, "you're missing a lot of fun in life." In spite of Fuchs's reserve, people liked him. He seemed so gentle and generous. Women often asked him to babysit on Saturday nights, and Fuchs always agreed. He put the kids to bed, then sat and read, listening to classical music. And Fuchs did open up a bit over time. He bought a beat-up blue Buick and gave people rides in Santa Fe. He tagged along on hikes and picnics. At one late-night party, he stunned everyone by downing a bottle of whiskey and leading a conga line. Then he excused himself politely, stepped behind the bar, and passed out. Friends tucked a sheet over him and went on with the party. "In the course of this work, I began naturally to form bonds of personal friendship," Fuchs later said. "I had to conceal from them my inner thoughts." The solution, he explained, was to explain two separate compartments in his mind. One compartment in which I allowed myself to make friendships, to have personal relations, to help people, and to be in all personal ways the kind of man I wanted to be. This is the Fuchs people saw. They sensed there was something more, something beneath the surface. No one guessed it was Fuchs' second compartment, the one he used for a secret mission. Everyone thought of him as a quiet, industrious man who would do just about anything he could to help our project, Hans Beth said. If he was a spy, he played his role beautifully.